The title is saying is BEXIS Tech Talk Series. So it's a series of technical talks. It's designed actually to introduce the current team members and also the future, potential future team members to know what is inside BEXIS, how we are developing this system and how it's expandable. We are going to have technical details, but not that implementation detail, let's say. It's like pointers to see where what is done, and then if you are going to contribute or continue, you can start from those pointers. As an introduction to BEXIS, I would like to introduce BEXIS Plus project and also the BEXIS product. BEXIS Plus is a project running for years. There's actually three main parts, which the biggest one is the BEXIS software development, as you see here, is proportional to the effort that we delegate to the task. There are some outreach and also training parts, which are obviously smaller. And the scope of this series is just on the first big part, which is the software development, and inside the BEXIS Plus. I'm saying BEXIS Plus because there is also a BEXIS project running, which we are going to take its place with some more introduction in the next slide, I guess. With the BEXIS software development, we are going to have a data management platform, which is more focused on the research projects, which means short to long-term projects, and we are going to play the role of repository for those projects, but not a permanent repository, or also not like a location for citable references and so on. So it's not a, I forgot the word actually. Let's say it's not a long time repository for the whole science. It's like for a small to medium sized projects. And hopefully when we discuss about the deployments, it's possible to have it also for the long-term projects, but it's not designed for that purpose. The main data that we are going to handle with this data management keywords is tabular data, but the system is not limited to that part. It means that our efforts are directed in the direction of managing tabular data. And also, we are going to encourage data integration and reuse so that within this platform, it's possible to integrate the system functions and also data with external systems, and also the elements of data, like the smaller elements of data, to be reusable inside another data set or inside another part of the whole data community. So current situation is that there is a BEXIS and BEXIS Plus as projects, which they have developed BEXIS 1 software, and now we are developing BEXIS 2 software. The trend is that everything that was done in BEXIS 1 should be ported to BEXIS 2, and also the projects that were using BEXIS 1, they will gradually migrate to BEXIS 2. As you see in this slide, I'm not sure, yeah, the mouse pointer is also working. This part are currently using BEXIS 1, and this part here are using BEXIS 2 software. We have a plan in collaboration with BEXIS 1 team to gradually move them to BEXIS 2 software platform when our functionality reached the amount of existing functions that are currently provided by BEXIS 1. We have also a list of partners and subcontractors that they are contributing to the project either financially or educationally or by collaboration in the development of the software and so on. And also they use and encourage the use of this software as we release regularly. About the Tech Talk series is, as I said, is a series of Tech Talks which we are going to talk about different parts of the software itself. So we are not talking about the training, and also we are not talking too much about why we have decided in this way. It's more that what we are doing or what we have decided to do. So any discussion regarding whys would be some sort of postponed for the late sessions or to the offline sessions, so that we can discuss about why we have decided on this technology or why we have decided on that language or about this component and so on. The purpose of this series of talks is that to promote knowledge sharing so that if there is a knowledge, it is not concentrated in minds and it is some sort of documentation. So we are actually documenting our knowledge, so it's shareable regardless of the location and time. And also foreigners, I mean foreigners to the team, can just grab this material online, hopefully, and then use it to get started to the work. And this talk that we have now is the first one, which is like a big picture that what is BEXIS, what is the environment that we are working on, and what are the requirements of this system, so that as a newcomer or as a first-time developer to this community, you will see what the system is and whether you like to contribute to it or not. So I want to start with the high-level requirements about the BEXIS. The BEXIS, as I said, is like a data management platform. With data management, normally the first thing is that what is data lifecycle? So we have a data lifecycle that when data arrives to the system, will go through that lifecycle. This lifecycle may or may not cover all your requirements in your research. So that, for example, if there is an analysis in your research, maybe it's not covered here. But if there is an archiving or providing citation references, maybe it's covered here. This lifecycle, the exact lifecycle, will be covered later in the next talks. But as a requirement, we have to support some sort of the data lifecycle. Another high-level requirement is that BEXIS++ is going to be generic in terms of not being bound to any specific domain. Because we currently are working in the biodiversity domain as projects, but the software is not going to be bound to the biodiversity or ecology or even a specific domain, whatever it would be. So we are trying to be as generic as possible, but it doesn't mean that we are going to solve all the problems. So whenever possible, we will cut the requirements in favor of our domains, but reluctant to do that. So being generic, as I said, means that we are not going to support everything, which opens another door. So okay, if we are not going to have everything, then the system should be expandable so that the others, or in the future, we can do it. So one of the main requirements is that whenever we implement something in the system, it should have some doors to get expanded or even to be replaced later with other groups or with other requirements. One of the other requirements is the portability of the system that we are developing. Is that because we are developing it as an open source and also a free system, it's very likely that it's used by different research groups and they have different settings, especially with the tools that are centralized to some projects, like database management systems, for example. So we are going to have this system portable so that if you have, for example, another operating system or another database management system, it should be possible to install BEXIS on those configurations and then hopefully use it without reducing the functionalities or losing any functionality. Maybe it should be open for inside now. And then the system is going to be scalable because we think that our users community can be a single PhD student doing some research to a big institution with a lot of projects. So the scalability matter in the deployment and also in the amount of data and the amount of data that is in transit to the system. So this kind of scalability requirements also are considered as much as possible into the system. With this high-level requirements, I will go through some of them. Like with the data lifecycle management, we would like to have flexible data structures because we know that different people or different research groups are working with different data, and those different data possibly have different data structures. So the data structure should be flexible, and we are not going, actually it's not practical, to force a specific, very generic data structure to everybody. The data submission can be different from project to project. Some data submissions go to peer reviewing, some go to validation processes, some just submissions need to upload some data, and so on. So this kind of different submission processes are also considered or should be considered. Validation as an entry point to data quality or control is also an integral part of the system. So any data lifecycle management should have some sort of validation, which means, for example, data type validation, data value validation, and a lot of other things, or correlation validation, and so on. So we will provide some basic validation scenarios, and with extensibility requirement, we would make it extensible so that extra validation are also possible to be integrated in the system. Preserving metadata management and versioning, I'm just going to make them shorter, are also part of the DLM, so that when data is submitted to the system, it should be preserved and accessible regardless of the location, regardless of other features, and so on. Metadata also should be available so that when people are looking for data, they should be able to find it using the metadata and get access to the actual data based on their search criteria. One of the things that we are keen to have it is the dataset versioning, because we know in the science data changed a lot, but it doesn't mean that the previous versions are invalid. They are just changed, so that we keep track of the changes, and also we are able to reproduce the previous version, so that if there is any citation, any algorithm, any work done on a previous version is, again, accessible regardless of the further changes that are applied to the data set. With the generic, we are going to have these two main requirements. One, the system to be modular, which means that we allow built-in and third-party modules to be integrated into the system so that they have their own UI, they have their own functions, and they also can use the main functionality provided by the system. And also they are able to intercommunicate and interoperate with other modules installed on the system. Workflows, as I said, for example, for data submissions are some sort of important. We are going to have two different kinds of workflows. One is the flow of the work, like data submission, and one is the flow of the interaction with the user, so that, for example, one data submission process can have multiple or different flows for different scenarios. Like, for example, you can start with metadata or start with the data. At the end, you have a data set with actual data and also metadata. So they are two different interactions, but one workflow that is data submission. So it's possible to have a combination of these different things to just make variety possible, so that if different institutes are using different workflows in their organization, in their paper-based system or their previous system, they can just reproduce that in BEXIS system and do it as smooth as possible. For the extensibility requirements, we are going to have a set of built-in modules like data lifecycle management and anything related to data lifecycle. We are having like few main entry point of third-party modules. One of the most important one is BEXIS 1 module. So everything or anything that is possible with BEXIS 1 will be converted to a module or a set of modules and integrated into BEXIS 2. We have some collaborating projects like Aquadiva and IDIV, which their requirement will be turned to some modules, if not already done, and then implemented by their own efforts or in collaboration with us. And also we accept open modules means that any third party module that is doing some realization on requirement can be formulated and developed and implemented in terms of some modules. Hopefully later when there are a number of this kind of open modules, we will have a like a repository of modules with some metadata, and then people can search for some modules and it, actually install them on their running system. Beside the modules, we have interaction with external systems. One of the basic ones is the GIS system, so that, for example, for visualized location-based searches, we are using a GIS system so that people can search there and find any data set that is relevant to a geographic extent or some attributes of a geographic location. Also with external persistent identifier providers to provide something like DOIs for data sets, so that data sets that are inside BEXIS system are also referenceable and citable via this PIDs. And we are in collaboration with some PID providers, so the data set, when they reach a specific quality level, they will be pushed to this repositories, obtain a PID, and then they are citable. And that is in integration with the version. So it's possible, for example, for a specific version of a specific data set to have a PID and the previous or later one have nothing. Also, we know that BEXIS is going to be used in organizations which have their authentication system in place. So that it would be good also that BEXIS can use their authentication provider to not duplicate the username and password and so on. So people with their sign-on system can also come to BEXIS and then just use a single sign-on mechanism here also. With the annotation providers, we are going to have actually data structures. Data structure in BEXIS consists of data attributes or variables that describe the data set. Those variables may have some ambiguous meaning or they have duplication and so on. With annotation providers, we are going to have like a semantic layer on top of variable so that the system or with the help of some experts knows that different variables have same meaning, so that with this same meaning concept or similar variables, we are going to have like dataset integration, merging different datasets, cross dataset search, and so on. And then with the portability requirements, one of the things that we are going to support is multi-DBMS supports, because we know that some organizations are bound to some specific databases, like for example, IBM DB2 or Postgres because it's free, or Microsoft SQL Server because they are using it for another purpose. So that it would be good if we also support this database management system so that they are not forced to change because of BEXIS. And various installation scenarios for different organizations or for different cases, like dedicated hosting for big projects, shared hosting for temporary or like field surveying and so on, portable hosting for demonstrations, for personal users and so on, and multi-tier deployment also for very big or high traffic system with redundancy or like availability requirements. And the secure access for those that are concerned about data transfer, data storage, credential passing and so on. With the scalability, it's more about the big projects that have multiple of users, like hundreds of users, very big data sets like data series or climate data, and very frequent access like that are master data with very low change frequency but very high read frequency. With this kind of projects, we are going to have those kind of distribution or load balancing and any hardware, software potential that can help us be available on large amount of requests and also big amount of data. So with these requirements, it should be obvious that we are not going to be a sophisticated data analysis tool. We are just data management tool, which means data storage, preserving, cleansing, and maybe very basic analysis, but not for the purpose of analysis, maybe for purpose of quality control and this kind of thing. And then the data analysis would be either offline from us or integrated tools by communication to us, not an integrated part of the system, or at least not an integrated part of the core system, which is always shipped with the basic model. And also, we are not going to be a long-term public repository keeping data for 20 years or providing PIDs and so on. It's more a research project or research project repository for like few years. And if the project owners have funding, they can continue. So it's not a system restriction, but it's more a project side restriction and also the permanent identifier restriction to us that puts this kind of limit and actually let us to make these two requirements out of scope. Maybe there are some smaller requirements that are out of scope that I will just mention them later. Okay, that's the first short break, like 30 seconds, if there's any question. And then we can continue with another aspect of the system.
Just one question maybe regarding the DB support for databases. Is there any consideration for NoSQL databases or non-relational databases?
Not really, there is nothing on our agenda. Yeah, that's... Yeah, the answer is no. There are some discussions, but no conclusion.
Okay.
Okay, then let's go to the second part. And if you're wondering, there are three parts. So there is one more short break in the middle somewhere. So with all the requirements, I would like to say that we are working on this conceptual model actually as our basis for the data management and also for the implementation. So this is the maximum thing that we will implement as the basic BEXIS. Anything else would be a module. And also it means that anything we implement is somehow a subset of this. Which means that we have lack of features almost anywhere. So if you are going to data, there are some lack of features there. If you go to semantics, there are more lack of features there, so and so on. Anything regarding to this packages would be in the development queue for the BEXIS 2 with the BEXIS plus team. Anything else would be a module that someone should take care and hopefully contribute it to the system. So the main thing that we are going to manage with our system is this data package, which contains actually the data set. To describe what the data means, we have another package here, which is the data structure. I will go through them a little bit in more detail in next slide. But the data structure for now is the description of the data, actually the description of the structure of data, like the variables, what this data means, and so on. And then the data is described in another aspect by the metadata, which is more human readable and also is about the whole data set in general, not single parts of it or single columns of it or single rows of it and so on. As data has some structure, metadata also has some structure. So that with this structure, metadata are comparable, machine readable, they can be used in automatic searches and so on. And to enhance the cross data set searches or integration and merging and so on, and also Like system-wide searches, we have the semantic package that help us to discover or to define the relationship between different data items, between different metadata items, and so on, and then use those knowledge for the searching, for the merging, and also for the integration. Here, the administration package provides like the context of ownership or collaboration to the data and the rest of the packages. Among them, like people are here, institutes are here, projects are here, geographical extents like size, plot, and so on are all here. So that, for example, if your data is talking about a specific location, that location information is here. If this data set is gathered by Project X, the project information is here, and so on. And also the relationship between the projects, people, and organization is captured also here. So security by default affects everything, but the mechanism of affecting is through the administration package, so that, for example, people here can be security users, or the relationship between the organization can be modeled as roles, and so on. This is the whole system that we call a DLM, which is the minimum requirement for the data management in BEXIS software. It's possible to extend all these packages if there is a module that, for example, needs some extra data that is not really external, but also not part of the minimum. It's possible to have something like a small amendments here around the packages. So with this short description, I would like to introduce some of the main important elements of this, like four or five of the packages. Like, for example, in the data package, we have the data set that can be tabular, matrix, unstructured, or any new structure that we will going to support. The data sets are versioned. They are actually consist of data tuples, with currently data tuples are going to be rows in a tabular structure, but this tuple can mean anything else also. Like, for example, in a matrix, it can be a single array location, or in multiple dimensional arrays, it can be a multi-dimensional location in an array, and so on. And also customization in this component is something that we are going to consider. Like, for example, maybe a subset of a data set, or a view of a data set for a specific purpose, or an automatic transformation of a data set from a metric system to an imperial system, and so on. This kind of customization levels are also part of the functions that this data component will provide. With the data structure, we have the main concept of data attribute, that is actually a variable describing one of the columns of a tabular data set, which can have real, like unit of measurements, constraints, value validation rules, and a lot of other things. But just consider it as a metadata of a single column in a data set. These are designed, or they are going to be designed for reuse promotion, so that we are going to, actually with this data structure component, to make the elements as discrete as possible, so that they are single independent entities reusable in different combinations. So for example, unit of measurements are something, independent of the data attributes, or the usage of their data attribute in different data structures, and so on. With this separation of the elements, then we have like, or we hope to have a limited list of these elements, and then with their combination, create any variety or any data structure that is needed by the researchers or the data managers in the research group. Metadata, as I said, is actually a collection of information describing a single data set. There are different metadata standards that we have to some sort of cover them. With this covering, it means that, for example, if someone is going to support EML in their BEXIS installation, it should be possible. So the design of metadata package then should not be bound to a specific standard, at the same time to be able to support that standard, which means that, for example, then mapping between different metadata should be possible, converting from one metadata to another should be possible, ingesting different data, metadata should be possible, and so on. These are some sort of side effects of supporting various metadata standards. Okay, and then metadata itself is considered as a data inside the system, so it also should have some structure, like the data that had data attribute here in metadata, we have also metadata attribute, but metadata attribute is going to be a little bit more complex because here we have like simple types and also compound types, that this compound type can be any combination of symbol and compound types again, which makes a like unlimited hierarchy of everything. And this should be some sort of well managed in term of data entry, in term of editing, in term of mapping or conversion, and so on. Again, here we are going to reuse promotion by having like semantic comparison of different metadata attributes to match them either automatically or semi-automatically, so that, for example, if you're going to convert from one metadata standard to another metadata standard, there should be some system support to help you to find out which compound type here is similar to which compound type there, and hopefully you get a better mapping at the end. And then with the administration package, we have to manage different contextual information like projects, organization, people, location, and relationship between them. This relationship may have temporal aspects like someone is an employee of an institute from some time to some time else, or is a project manager from a specific time to a specific another time. And during that project management role, he or she has different authorization rules in the system. So all these things are some sort of integrated and should be considered. Okay, that was the conceptual view of the system. Now I'm going to switch to the design view. With the design view, we have three main elements. One is the data itself. One is the functionality that we are going to provide. And one architecture that somehow accommodate this functionality and data management in robust system so that it's extensible and so on. With the data, I guess from the requirements and also from the packages that I showed, is obvious that we are dealing with the complex data structure, which consists of relational data, for example, for the tuples, for people, for organization, and so on. It has a lot of XML data for those hierarchical or dynamic data structures. We have to consider files because if we support, for example, data submission, data may come in any format, coming from logger machines, coming from Excel for individual projects, coming from images like satellite images or sample images and so on. Also internally, we would have a lot of configuration for system behavior, for module behavior, for settings, and so on. And then when system is going to run for the first time, it would need some basic data that we call it seed data. This seed data may be, for example, the unit of measurement, basic unit conversions, basic data attributes that are like very generic ones, and so on. So all these different data should be somehow managed to fit into one architecture and work in a robust and consistent way. And also we have geographical data either for the search or part of the metadata or even part of the data tuples as location of a measurement, for example. So in different levels of granularity, we have geographical data integrated. And all this should work together in one system or as one system. With the functionality, we have some core functionality that are mostly around the data lifecycle management, which are data sets, data structure, metadata and data structure, versioning, and this kind of thing. And then with the AAA, we are going to have authentication, authorization, and auditing as part of the core system, so that no one, for example, no another module is going to be able to bypass the AAA, so that, for example, no module should be able to bypass the authentication to do something without authentication, or to do something without authorization, or to do something silently if you are going to audit everything. So, for example, if you are going to log every delete, no module should be able to delete something without recording that I have deleted this report. And these policies are just set in the main core functionality so that no module can override or bypass them. And with the architecture, we are going to have some sort of components like the two that I mentioned, DLM and AAA, like the transformations from XML to XML for metadata, from CSV to Excel for data, or to anything else that will come later. And then there should be some sort of module integrated into architecture, which their difference or main difference to the components is that they can be working in multi-layer, specifically with the modules. We want them to have user interaction so that they can cross different layers, starting from the user, going to the UI, going to the service or API layers, and also going to the data. And these three are just some examples of the modules. For example, data collection module is collecting data from an end user and then putting it into the system storage, which means just the whole life cycle of an operation is considered inside the module, but components are not allowed to cross different layers. They are just working in one layer. So, for example, a component that is working in data layer has no interaction with the user, but modules are allowed to interact with the user and also interact with other modules based on some restrictions. And then the whole architecture or whole system would have some external dependencies. One of them is some sort of GeoServer for the geographical functionalities. We would have some services that we would rely on them, like terminology servers for those kind of semantic integrations. Persistent identifiers for obtaining or to submitting data set to PID providers, and also external authentication providers for single sign-on. So as we are using some services, we would also provide some public services that other systems, based on some restriction or contracts or authorization rules, will be able to use them, like, for example, REST services for downloading a data set or a specific version of a data set, or metadata harvesting for bigger repositories that are doing this harvesting based on some schedule, for example, and some interfaces for well-known scientific analysis tools like the R system. And this means, for example, an R user should be able to connect to a BEXIS instance and request for a specific data set and get it inside their R system as an, for example, data frame and start doing analysis there in their R system. So the whole process should be done inside R without leaving the R scripting or R, R scripting studios or editors. The second break. Any question, anything here? Okay, and then let's jump to another aspect, which is the development environment that we are going to use or to somehow bound to use. From the toolset perspective, we are using Visual Studio, different versions of Visual Studio, I guess we are using from 2010, 2015, so any combination of these Visual Studios are acceptable, but the later the better. For the task management and source control management, we are using Team Foundation Server. But also we would have the public releases or maybe the whole source code on GitHub, because the system is going to be open. Actually, it's open source, but it's going to be openly accessible also. So at minimum, the public releases would be accessible through GitHub, and at maximum, the whole development source code and all the branches would be there. Something with the GitHub I forgot to say. Maybe. Okay, then we are using .NET ecosystem. Specifically, we are programming in C#. Currently, it should be 4.5.2 something. Every few months, we just upgrade if there is something new in the whole ecosystem. For the development pattern, we are basically using MVC with some modification, some small modification that we will see in more detail in later talks. And then for data access or dealing with databases, specifically dealing with relational databases, we are using object relational mapping or ORMs. And also for client-side programming, we are basically using jQuery plus some UI components from different providers, but completely open source or free software. So using BEXIS or developing in BEXIS doesn't force or doesn't imply any financial aspect, except the tools that anybody can use, like Visual Studio, is their licensing is out of our control. But the components that we use inside the development stream are just free and compatible with the open source license that we use. And then with the database management systems, we use, and also we would use more, but currently they are DB2 from version 9 and upper, Postgres version 8 and upper, and Microsoft SQL Server 2000 and upper. The amount of development or testing on these three main streams are different from release to release, but basically when we release means that they work on all of this variant DBMS system. The system should be deployed on Microsoft IIS or Internet Information Server, version 7 and upper. Dedicated hosting is tested and works, and also we would always support this dedicated hosting. Virtual machine hosting for demos or for portability is also hosting, is supported. Portable hosting on single laptops or client machine, from time to time we support it, but there is no real guarantee. That is always supported on all combinations. It's like every few releases we just test it as a second level or as like a lower priority hosting. And multi-tier deployment is something also should be supported or is on our deployment plan, but currently we don't do multi-tier deployment for no reason. So that was the whole big picture for the first talk. The second talk that would be hopefully in January is about the conceptual model in more detail. The conceptual model we have seen here as just one slide plus some explanation, but is like a single session dedicated to this conceptual model. During that conceptual model talk, I would also describe some sort of database design or database design rules that we have, and then gradually we just switch to the technical details, implementation details, and so on. I guess that would be the last one, except this acknowledgement and saying thank you for being here and paying attention. Thank you.